name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Special word of welcome to the confirmation candidates from all the way from Parks and Stevens. It's good to have you with us. And then also all who are visiting and joining us for the first time or after a very long period. Nice to have you here. And also to our parishioners at the end of the live stream of our Mass this morning. Praise the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Let us pray the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let us confess our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in unison of life.
To the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you. Pardon your sins and set you free from them, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray the collect for this day. Most High God, majestic and mighty, our beginning and our end, rule in our hearts and guide us to be faithful, worshiping the one who comes as Savior and Sovereign, and who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is read in isiXhosa from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 34. Ukukhathalela kwenkosi umhlambi wawo. Ngokuba itsho inkosi uYehova ukuthi, yabonani, mna ngokwam ndiyakukhathalela umhlambi wam ndiwuvelele. Njengoko umalusi awuvelelayo umhlambi wakhe, ngemini yokuba kwakhe phakathi komhlambi wakhe uthiwe saqo. Ndiyakwenje njalo ukuvelela umhlambi wam. Ndiwuhlangule ezindaweni zonke owakubalusali kuzo ngemini enamafu amnyama. Ndiyakukhupha ezizweni, ndiwubuthe emazweni, ndiwuse emhlabeni wawo, ndiwalusele ezintabeni zakwaSirayeli, ezihlanjeni nasezindaweni zonke ezimiweyo zelizwe. Ndiyakuwalusela ebutyanini obulungileyo, libe sezintabeni ezinde zakwaSirayeli idlelo lawo. Edlelweni elilungileyo uyakubutha khona, udle utyani obutyebileyo ezintabeni zakwaSirayeli. Mna ndiyakuwalusa umhlambi wam, ndiwenze ubuthe mna, itsho iNkosi uYehova. Ezilahlekileyo ndiyakuzifuna, ndibuyise ezizintsali. Ndibophe ezaphukileyo, ndizomeleze ezifayo, ke ezityebileyo ndozitshabalalisa, nezo zomeleleyo ndizaluse ngokusesikweni. Ngoko ke itsho iNkosi Yehova kuzo ukuthi, yabonani, mna ndiyakugweba phakathi kweegusha ezityebileyo neegusha ezinqinileyo. Ngenxa enokuba nityhala ngehleza nangegqalaba, nizihlabe ngeempondo zenu ezi zityhafileyo zonke, nide ke nizenze zibe lusali, zigqibe ilizwe. Ndowasindisa ke umhlambi wam, ungabi sabalixhoba, ndigwebe phakathi kwegusha negusha. Ndomisa phezu kwawo umalusi abemnye, awaluse umkhonzi wam uDavide. Yena uya kuwalusa abe ngumalusi wawo. Mna Yehova ndibe nguThixo wawo, umkhonzi wam uDavide abe sisikhulu phakathi kwawo. Mna Yehova ndithethile nje. Hear the word of the Lord.
we say Psalm 100, the congregation responds with the bold print. Oh, shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his face with songs of joy. Come into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now.
The second reading, the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love towards all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks to you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe. According to the working of his great power, God put his power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and he has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Here is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Listen to the good news proclaimed in the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep on his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly, I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me.' And he will say to those at his left hand, 'You are all accursed. Depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me.' And then they will also answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' And then he will answer them, 'Truly, I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." This is the Gospel of Christ.
May I speak in the name of God's beloved. I'm sure many of you would recall the name of Susan Boyle. She appeared on the Great Britain's Got Talent, I think it was 2009. And there's the offstage banter between Susan and the fellows that kind of ushers people on and off and tries to keep them calm. And in that conversation, she makes mention that she's in her 40s. And then you see her walking up, and she is not entering a beauty competition. So she doesn't aspire as such, but you can see how the audience is already looking quite cynically towards her, as does the two men judges, or two male judges, and then the lady in between. But it's Simon Cowell who, in a later interview, he said when he saw her, and he said, "I'd been having a really bad day." And when he looked at Susan, he really hoped that she wouldn't be singing. And then he almost dismissively asked, "Who are you? What's your name?" And then she gives it, and then he asked her, "How old are you?" I remember my mother-in-law saying, "My wage and my age," or vice versa, "my age and my wage is my business." And I could see, but Susan takes it in a stride. And then he asks her this question, and I wrote it down just to make sure that I remembered. He says, "How old are you?" And then she gives him her age, and she then shifts from being 40 to 47, right? In the full glare now of global television. And then he asks her, "What's the dream?" And she says, "I'm trying to get into professional singing." And then he asks her, "Why hasn't it worked out before?" And then she says, "I've never been given the chance before." And everybody looks at her. And then she sings, you know. I hope my daughter captures what is happening here. I'm not going to play the whole thing.
"I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
I play the songs not so much only for the lyrics, but it's just the contrast visually between this lady and this purity of voice and of song that comes forth. And it's from Les Miserables, and it's where the character that's singing had just lost a job, and she's out on the street, and she sings the song. And then at the last verse I'll read to you, "I had a dream of how my life would be so different from this hell I'm living, so different now from what it seemed. Now life has killed the dream I dreamed." How life has killed the dream I dreamed. So we have this contrast of where Jesus is talking about the reign of God. And the measurement of that reign is how we look and care for those who are on the periphery. People these days use the word, we are outliers. And it's in contrast to the beatitudinal life that has been individualized about, you know, the pure of heart shall be called the children of God, and the blessed poor, they shall be the inheritors. The sorrowful will be comforted. Those who are gentle, the gentle will inherit the earth. And those who hunger and thirst for justice, their yearning will be satisfied. The merciful, they shall be granted mercy. The pure in heart, they shall see God. And the peacemakers are called to be and will be called the children of God. And if we look at the story of the sojourn, the calling of the Israelites, they enter into a beautiful covenant with God, where God says, this I will provide you, a home, I will provide you security, I will keep you safe. And the basic requirement is in Deuteronomy that, amongst other verses in the Hebrew scriptures, you must look after the widow, the orphan, and the stranger in the land. Honor that, the basics, because that is then the fulfillment of the agreement. And that agreement is seldom honored. And then God sends the prophets to keep the house of Israel focused on the covenant agreement. And it continues to be broken even when they cross the River Jordan into the land that is now Palestine. Eventually, from the house of David comes Jesus in all the ways that he is present. And he presents the beatitude. And today in the gospel reading, there is the emphasis on, when did I see you? When did I feed you? And those are the hallmarks, not only of individual piety, acts of charity, but is how the kingdom, the reign of God, is also expressed in the nation state. It's a very basic requirement. And we tend to domesticate a lot of the gospel teaching, and in this moment also, but it's the ultimate witness is fulfilled in how the society is often measured, the strength of its economy, how it weighs up against the sterling and the dollar, and then that's a good state. A few years ago, I was invited to Kingston, Jamaica, to attend a conference on homosexuality and the failure of a lot of the Caribbean states to agree to the basic tenet of how we accept everybody as God has made them and not as we qualify them according to heterosexuality. And while I was there, I opportunistically asked the person who had invited me, can I go via Cuba? And I had this understanding you can fly from Kingston to Havana at Vekisuni. You had to go via Miami. And I spent a week as the guest of the dean of the Cathedral of Havana, the Episcopalian dean. And on my third day, we were driving, he was taking me all over Kingston, or rather Havana. And I remember I was so excited because I liked Cuban jazz particularly. And we were walking past this place. I said, what is that place? He said, it's jazz. There the door closed on my jazz in Havana. And then he was a lovely guy, and sometimes I think, like many deans, won't mention names, can be a bit grumpy. None of you are laughing. So obviously it's not me. It's not me. It must have been my predecessors. And I asked him, I said, I noticed something that I don't see at home. I said, do you have people living on the street? And he looked at me affronted. He said, why? For him, it was as if I was putting him to the test. A few years before that, a South African who in his late teens, early 20s, who had in the 1950s jumped ship in Havana, he ends up being entertained in a pub in Havana, and the consequence of that conversation is the next day he's trekking up into the Sierra Maestra, where he meets Fidel Castro and Che Guevara, a homeboy from Salt River, a devout Catholic. And eventually, years after the revolution in Havana, he is able to return now as a grandfather to his hometown, to Cape Town, and he's being hosted by his very devout Catholic families. And the one elder or the younger brother says, you know, Ron, at least now your quality of life will be different, and the poverty that you experience in Havana is no more. And there was a kind of conversation around in the kind of pre-conversation to the meal. And then Ron asked very gently if he could say a few words. And they said, yeah, sure. And then he said, you know, in Cuba, you're right. We don't have what we have in Cape Town and in Greater South Africa. But in Cuba, the little food that we have is shared. And no one goes to bed hungry. The basic measurement of the standard of living. Everything else that we might critique of the party, the governing party there, but the essence of the absence of homeless people, the absence of begging. And when I was there, I didn't see that. Don't know what happens behind people's closed doors, but on the open face of the public domain, the quality of life is what Jesus is saying here. To feed, to house, to visit in prison, to familiarize yourself with a lot of the poor. And he says, if you do that, you are doing that unto me. And so God comes into our lives individually and collectively as a beggar. It is God who speaks to us in the voice of the beggar. On Friday after breakfast, I'm walking down with John Allen from Bree Street, and just closer to the cathedral, a 17-year-old young woman asked me, she said, you're a pastor? I said, yeah, I'm a priest. He says, please, some money for bread. And I said, I don't have any money. And then she said, and you call yourself a priest and you a liar. And I, embarrassed and humiliated, because there are other people standing by, and I just said, just lekom beskof. That was my only defense, that you are rude. So the poor doesn't always have got good manners. The homeless are not always very civil. They have been stripped of all dignity, and it is our responsibility not judge them by how they behave, how they interact with us. Because, as Susan Boyle says, when she's asked, why has this dream not been fulfilled? She says, because I've never been granted the opportunity. And when she has a whiff of that opportunity, she grabs it with all her being. A lot of our people living here, right here on the Cape Flats, have been denied generational fulfillment of their dreams. Once their great-grandparents have been tossed out, whether it's now from Fanny Dorp, Da and Perel, in Vila Noble in New Orleans, or Waukal, or whether it's in Haderveld or Manenberg, recovering that generational dispossession, it takes it forever, and that's why we need the collective ability and resources of a governing state to enable us to be alert to that which Susan grabs and sings a dream that takes her out of the village complex outside London into which she had been born, and which she had been told that she's not a beauty queen, where she has been reinforced that she is not of sufficient intelligence. It's only later on they find out that on the autistic spectrum, she has an above intelligence, intellect, above average intellect. And so just a little nudging of possibilities. And likewise, however you and I might see ourselves, however we might see ourselves as not being pure of heart Oh, the piety of the merciful. In whatever we fall short of the beatitudinal standard, there is an affirmation here that comes from Jesus, the least I am there. So the less qualified we are, the less able we are, the less caring of others we are, in all the negativity of the covenanted understanding that Jesus personifies, Jesus is also the presence of God. And we're in the reading today of from Ephesians, to see with the inner eye. And in the little prince, it is said, the inner eye, it is only with the heart that we can see rightly. It's only with the inner eye of having the stamp of the seal of God's Holy Spirit that enables us, and we have it, it's lying dormant in ourselves. Claim the truth and believe the dream that is not going to be fulfilled in the future, but the dream of the reign of God here. And we are populating it. And we can defeat the nightmare of what is happening all around us. When I saw what is happening on a daily basis in the Levant, in Israel, in Palestine, I felt within my being there is a shifting in our humanity. And this day's reading from the gospel is a corrective to that. This is, do not lose hope. Hold yourself accountable to that. Where you have not been the good Samaritan, where you have crossed over the other side, away from the victim of history, where you are the victim of history, it's not forsaken. At the right time, we are invited to either be the good Samaritan, or we are privy to receive the care of the good and the caring Samaritans in our lives. Embrace it, believe it, and feel how it is to be loved. Amen. Please stand as we affirm our faith. We believe in one God, the Father. Please be seated or kneel as you are able. The responses to the prayers, I will say, Your kingdom come in us, Your kingdom come in us, and the congregation responds, as it is in heaven, as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come in us. You are the King of glory, O Christ. You are the everlasting Son of the Father. May your kingdom come in us on earth as it is in heaven. Christ, we confess you as King of kings and Lord of lords. Come rule in our hearts and claim us part of your kingdom. We seek to dedicate our lives to you and to your glory. And as we stand at the edge of the liturgical year, anticipating Advent Sunday and season, we pray for all who are working for the bringing in your kingdom, for those striving for justice, for peace and freedom. Your kingdom come in us. We pray for all leaders of governments, for all leaders of nations, members of parliament, that they may govern with gentleness and integrity. O most loved divine, we remember all who suffer from injustice. We pray for the scorned and the rejected people of our world, for all who have lost their freedom, for all who are deprived of their basic rights. We pray for the work of Amnesty International and our own gift of the givers. Your kingdom come in us. Come, Lord, rule in our hearts, in our homes, and in our lives. Come and transform us, your people. Your kingdom come in us. This day we especially also pray for this congregation, for those at home and those who we work with or gather at school, in whatever way we experience community. We pray for all who are struggling, for those who cannot cope, for people who need protection, longing for some taste and measure of salvation. Oh Father, we bring before you the hungry, the thirsty and the naked, the prisoners and the homeless. We pray for our loved ones, our friends who are in need. Your kingdom come in us. Christ, O King, ruler of heaven and earth, in you we triumph over darkness and death, and in you we have life eternal. We pray for all our loved ones who have departed this life, and we commend to your eternal blessedness the person, Lord, that I administered to the last rites on Thursday in Vincent Pilotti, and who passed away in the evening of the Friday. We pray for her, for Catherine, for her husband Michael, and all those who were there at her side when she passed from this life. We pray for all who have passed on here in our city, either in the quiet of their homes or in the care of hospitals, or the grim fatalities on the streets of gang warfare, of robbery in the cities of our land. We pray for those who are under the hope of the ceasefire in Israel and Gaza. Lord, with all its shortcomings and fault lines, we pray that the seeding of this moment of quiet at night, may that continue not as a negotiated political arrangement, but a sealing of hearts and minds. Father, we know that in any struggle of oppressor and the oppressed, that they are no angels, that iniquity even finds its way into those who aspire to be pure of heart, to those who struggle and thirst after justice in whatever way it is imagined. We pray for the presence of your angels in whatever form they are needed and the way that they are present amongst the medical fraternity. Find your way, Lord, into the hearts of the general with a command to instruct the finger on the trigger. For those who seek the safety and the sanctuary of the tunnels of Gaza, keep us, Lord, sustained in our humanity, that we will not be corralled and shackled into whatever ideology informs our mind and our consciousness. We pray that we will be one with your saints of history and of the now, and that setting our hearts on things above, we may be raised up to where you reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit forever. Your kingdom come in us. These things we pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Friends, as you would have heard, that we are now at the end of the liturgical year, and then next Sunday we will have the Advent Sunday, and Father Derek Pratt will be our guest preacher. And then in the evening we will have our carol service. So we look forward very much to that. Craig has given me a brown envelope. But it's really for your information. It's about pledging and beginning the pledge drive. So please make sure that you do not leave your empty-handed, and the dutiful members of the hospitality ministry, also known as the side persons, will ensure that you do receive this. And then just a little mistake here in the pew leaflet on the front page. It should be 18 hours, which is 6 p.m. and not. Whatever we're not doing right, we definitely still observe evensong in the evening and not at 8 a.m. in the morning. So just for those who might have arrived, I'm so sorry. We also have a birthday. Was it Saturday or Friday? Saturday passed. Ayanda. Or was it yesterday? Anyway, we had a birthday. And so, any other birthdays? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to Ayanda. Happy birthday to you. You're not gonna go Stevie Wonder today. I am too not so frisala today. Congregation, please stand. And let's just channel our Bob Marley. To the person on your left, you say, everything is gonna be all right. To the left. And to the right, everything is gonna be all. Kusini Manson Pedal. Sumnandi Fandah. Nice having you with us. Beloved, may the peace of the living Lord always be with you. is the first Eucharistic prayer, and the service continues on page 116 in the Anglican prayer book. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. For us it becomes the bread of life. And blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. For us it becomes the cup of salvation. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and indeed our duty and joy. Lord and Heavenly Father, God Almighty and Eternal, always and everywhere to give thanks through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. And now we give you thanks because you sent Jesus to share our sufferings and bear our sorrows and reveal through him your power to make us whole. And therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we acclaim you and declare the greatness of your glory. We praise you now and forever, saying,
Wasiqekeza wabanika abafundi bakhe esithi, thabathani nitle, lo kuzimba wam nikalelwa nina, oku kwenzeleni ukundikhumbula. Kananjalo emva kwesitlo sangokuhlwa wathabatha indebe, waza akubebulele kuwe, wabanika yesithi, selani kuya nonke, kubale likazi lam nomxhobiso omtsha, alipalalena nina nabaninzi, ukuze izono zixolelwe, kamaxesha onke enisikubanisela kuyo, okukhwe zeleni ukundikhumbula.
So we proclaim the mystery of faith. Heilige Vader, met die gave het U aan vir ons, U mense, die een volmaakte offer Christus, onze Heere, sy opstanding in die dode en sy opvaart naar die hemelse heerlijkheid. Genadige Heere, neem ons in hom aan, al is ons onwaardig, zodat ons wat deelneem aan die lichaam en bloed van die Seun, nou in die eeuwen een mag wees met alle gelowiges.
Here at the violence wacht op die wederkomst van Christus ons verlosser in die heerlijkheid en triomf van sy koninkrijk. Ons dagelijks mag toeneem in gelijkvormigheid aan sy beeld. Met wie en in wie en deur wie in die kracht van die Heilige Geest alle eer en heerlijkheid aan u gegee word, almachtige Vader, die hele gemeenskap op aarde en in die hemel, die eeuwe heen, nou en vir eeuwig. And so as Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing. The bread which we break is our sharing of the body of Christ.
We who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread.
We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ,
and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us.
And so, beloved, draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Feed on him in your heart, by faith, with thanksgiving. Behold who we are.
May we become what we receive.
give thanks unto the Lord, for God is gracious. Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice in Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to love and work to your praise and glory. So the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the love and the knowledge of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. I just ask that the sides persons or members of the hospitality I hope that the people at the Arjuna make an important announcement. Friends, as you can see, these are, if you can just, if you don't mind, just opening the photo album. See here, in all our diversity, these are our sides persons. And they do a wonderful job, they're steadfast. And we're rolling up for the big event of the Midnight Mass, and we will also need to increase their number. When I first came here as a visitor to the cathedral, Uncle Jack used to do both duty on the car park and also here. And so we really want to strengthen our diversity, to have more women and more younger people to join this mighty band of soldiers, these warriors. Look at Ron. He's a Uti. So please, as we thank them, we also want to increase their number. So please, we're not going to go to you to pressurize you to come, but this might be a place where you feel God wants you to be, and particularly if you've got a nice smile and a gentle hand. But let's thank them for... Thank you very much. They like that Anglican hymn, "Oh love that wilt not let me go." Friends, and I was just saying to the 7 o'clock congregation that when I started the ministry, I looked at the priest, you know, and there was a lot of old priests. And I would often think of in later years of Father Reza Alexander, I did my second curacy under him, and Father Bob, I did my diaconate, and there was Canon Sylvester, Ronnie Jonathan, and others. And then the other day, I just reminded myself, I am now an old priest. It's not them now, I am now arrived at a point. And something that old priests do is that when it comes to the season of Advent, during Lent we fast, and then in Advent we practice more abstinence, just a little bit in moderation. But when we came to the events that I lightly referred to in my sermon, the question of what was happening on 7:10 in the Levant, I just had a stirring in my heart, a conviction that something is shifting in our global humanity. And in as much as when we just see, when things go overspending in New York, global consequences of the global warming, the people in Kenya are experiencing floods and the like. So whatever happens everywhere in the world, it does impact on us. The war in the Ukraine, impacted on our resources on a variety of levels. And I have decided in consultation with Benita, I informed and consulted Archbishop Tabo and Bishop Joshua, the members of chapter, my confessor and others, that I, with effect from this coming Wednesday, which is International Solidarity with Palestine, that I would embark on a fast that when it comes to Human Rights Day, December 16, I will review it, but most likely will continue into beyond Christmas, which I'm not very committed to. You know, roast lamb is very part of my religion on Christmas Day, but at the same time, next Sunday we're going to have Advent carols. That people in Bethlehem won't be able to do that. People in Jerusalem, in Hebron, and Ramallah, and all those places where there are Christian celebration of the season and the markers of the season won't happen. And so I will be fasting for a period and inviting people to join me, either in person here at the cathedral. I'm still thinking of spending at least a night in the link, but I'm not so sure about that. But I just want you to know as a congregation that when it becomes public, the family must know first. So please hold me in prayer and all those who join me. And I hope many of you will be able to do that. Please stand.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Friends, I've just been reminded that I need to let you know that the lectionaries are available at the Black Sabbath cost of 50 rand. So please, on the left as you go up.